The train Amon hasn't stopped driving for 17 days. I was jolted back to consciousness by a violent coughing fit caused by the unnaturally dry air around me. Drops of sweat had piled up and started trickling down my forehead. It was dark, not a single ray of light to even make out my closest surroundings. My memory served little help in recognizing my whereabouts, but upon fumbling around with my weak hands, I noticed I was sitting in a fabric-coated chair in a room that seemed to vibrate ever so slightly. As my eyes started to adapt to the overwhelming darkness, I could start to make out the vague shape of my room. There were three seats facing each other with windows on the right-hand side, though they revealed nothing more than an empty void on the other side. On the other side was a door with a small window, which led out into a hallway, and it then dawned on me where I had woken up. It was a train compartment, and the train was still moving, though seemingly rid of any other people. I tried to get up, but my legs refused to properly cooperate. They were too weak, as if they hadn't been used for days. Then some of my memories returned. I was traveling. I remembered getting on the train, though I hadn't the faintest idea what my destination should have been. My memory simply cut short after stepping inside my empty compartment. That had been November 12th. I checked my pockets to look for clues. I found my phone, which had long since ran out of power, and my wallet. Though it contained a ticket, in the dark it just looked like weird scribbles on a piece of paper. With an incredible amount of effort, I finally managed to get my legs working enough to stand up, though I had to use the wall as support. It was enough to move around, and I soon stumbled into the hallway of my train car. I took a moment to look through the windows in the hallway, and the world outside was empty. It both looked and felt as if nothing existed outside the boundaries of the train. The darkness made it hard to navigate without falling to the ground. I tried to look for a light switch, or at the very least another person to help me out, but none were in sight. I peeked in through the window into the next compartment, and I could see the vague shape of people sitting still in their seats, but upon trying to enter, I realized that the door was locked. I tried to knock, but the people on the other side didn't even flinch. When I tried to call out for them, I realized my voice had almost completely vanished, replaced by just a whisper. I made my way from compartment to compartment, and while they all seemed to be occupied, none would open, and not a single person responded to my increasingly frantic knocks. As I reached the last compartment of the car, the train turned ever so slightly on its tracks, enough to knock me to the ground. While I lay there, I tried to call out for help with my barely audible voice, but no one could hear me. I got to my feet while the train still turned, and noticed the door to the last compartment slowly glide open from the turn. "Hello, can anyone hear me?" I called out with a trembling voice as I approached the open door. No response, either because the compartment was empty, or because my voice hadn't been used for so long that barely functioned. I slowly peeked my head around the corner to see the compartment fully occupied by dark figures, all of them sitting perfectly still in their seats. "Hello," I said again. I took a step inside. My eyes had started to fully adjust to my dark surroundings, and I quickly realized that not only were the people sitting perfectly still, but they weren't even breathing. The horrible thought of them being dead struck me like a hammer, but I had to make sure. I bent down on my knees next to the closest man and shook him gently. Still, he didn't respond. I then checked for a pulse, and though I am not a doctor, I couldn't find any signs of life. I heard a small beep that shot me to my feet, and looked down to see the man wearing a digital watch that alerted him that an hour had passed. I looked at the watch and noticed the date was also written in the center. 29th of November. It had been 17 days since I boarded the train. With a trembling hand, I checked the rest of the people for signs of life. All of them were beyond a shadow of a doubt. Dead. Panic arose in my body, both from the presence of dead people and from the realization that I'd been asleep on a moving train for more than 2 weeks. I collapsed to the ground in front of one of the dead passengers. She was an elderly woman, dressed elegantly with wide open, piercing blue eyes. I didn't want to stay in the compartment with them, but I was paralyzed by the lack of a plan. There I sat, surrounded by six dead people, trying to contemplate my next step. The train was still moving, which clearly meant that someone had to be in control of it. A conductor, or at least someone with an idea as to what the hell was going on. So, I decided that my best bet would be to make my way to the locomotive, and pray that not everyone had died. On the train, all the while these thoughts ran through my head. I couldn't take my eyes off the elderly lady. Something just felt off by their presence. Firstly, there wasn't any smell, meaning they hadn't started to decompose. And secondly, all of them had their eyes open wider than I thought possible. Before I could consider the bizarre situation any further, the woman suddenly blinked. I shot to my feet in horror. As she blinked again, I double-checked her pulse. Still nothing. Yet, her eyes kept blinking without any other signs of life. In shock, I looked around to find that the other five Dead passengers were also blinking rapidly. Without checking them for life, I jumped out from the compartment and shot the door. I noticed a chunk of wood missing from it, as if someone had kicked it in, leaving it unable to properly close. As I slowly backed away from the compartment, I glimpsed out through the windows, into the empty void beyond. I humored the thought that we might be driving through a tunnel, but if so, how long could it possibly be? I stepped into the next train car. Unlike the previous one, it wasn't divided into compartments, but rather filled with rows of seats, split in the middle by a central passage. But, like the compartments, each seat was occupied by a dead passenger, each blinking in response as I quickly passed in panic. I walked through about 15 such cars, each alternating by rows of seats and compartments. It felt like hours passed as I made my way towards the locomotive. And just as I was about to enter through a door marked first class, I was shoved to the floor by someone holding a bright light to my face. "Stay the duck down," a deep voice shouted at me. Speechless, I could do nothing but comply with the man in front of me. "Wait, you're not dead?" the man asked, as he realized I was basically just a kid, barely in my 20s. He moved the light away from me and reached out a hand to help me up. "I am sorry. I just heard someone moving and knew you were one of them," he said as he pointed to the lifeless people sitting idly by in their seats. "What's your name?" he asked. I am Thomas," I stuttered, as the shock from the bright light faded. I saw that the man was dressed in a police uniform, well built and bald. "The name's John Hendricks," he said, "and we better get out of there before these bastards wake up again." "They're not dead?" I asked. "Yeah, well, not exactly. It's like they're in hibernation." I looked at him in confusion. "People in hibernation? They ain't people, kid. Not anymore." As he spoke those words, he seemed surprised by something behind me. "Duck, I was too slow," he said, oddly calm. I turned around to see the people moving their heads around, all of them staring directly at us, their eyes now fixed and unblinking. "We need to get out of here," John said as he pulled my arm and dragged me in through the door to another compartment car, though far nicer than the one I'd awoken in. All the doors had opened, and people were slowly piling out from each compartment into the hallway, staring at us with their wide open eyes. We dove into the first available compartment, and the officer pushed one of the people out from it and locked the door. He sighed. "We'll be safe here for a bit. Hopefully they're just scouting." "What the hell is—" I started saying before the cop put his hand over my mouth, gesturing for me to keep quiet.
"Keep it down, would ya?" he said quietly, clearly agitated by my idiocy.
"What's happening?" I whispered.
"We've got to hold up here until they go back to sleep." He stood up and peeked out the window into the hallway, before pulling down quickly back behind cover.
"The other passengers, what happened to them?" I asked.
"Dead.
Most of them anyways. Got a few survivors camped up in the dining car. I just came out to look for batteries, hoping we could get a phone working and get help."
"How the hell did you survive here all on your own?"
"I don't know. I just woke up an hour ago," I said. I took out the ticket from my pocket and tried to read it. Officer Hendricks took his flashlight and set it to its lowest setting to help me read. The text on the ticket was a language I didn't recognize, just jumbled symbols and a date.
"Yeah,
it's the same with all of our tickets as well. None of this makes any damn sense. Do you remember where the train is going?" I asked. He shook his head. "The people out there seem fairly docile. Can't we just push our way through? They don't seem to be moving," I asked.
He sighed again.
"I am not afraid of the things out there. It's what comes next that terrifies me."
"What is it?"
"Hell, I don't even know what it really looks like. It's massive and dark. It just uses those things to look around for survivors. We call them—" As tried to finish the sentence, a large thud could be heard on the other side of the door. I carefully peeked out through the window to see that all the people had collapsed back to the ground, and that the door leading to the car behind us had opened up. A tall, obsidian black created pulled its way inside using large tendril-like appendages. It had thin stumps that resembled legs, and multiple more tendrils that slithered on along the walls, seeming to sense its surroundings. Though it was vaguely humanoid in nature, it didn't have a head, nor any eyes. John lifted a finger to his lip and signaled for me to keep absolutely silent. I noticed then he had a gun holstered, attached to his belt. I pointed to it without saying a word, but he just shook his head in response. The creature moved closer, and before long it was standing just outside the door, its arms spread out, flattening out and covering the window. It started to form small cracks in the glass pane, allowing small tendrils to seep through.
"God damn it,"
John whispered as sweat poured down his face. Suddenly, he stood up and kicked the door, breaking it straight off its hinges. It barely fazed the creature, but it allowed us for enough wriggle room to bolt past it. He grabbed me and pushed me through the gap between the wall and the creature, getting caught up in its tendrils as he did. They latched onto him and buried into his leg.
"Run," He yelled in agony as he tried to fight off the tendrils wrapping around him. Still feeling weak, I fell onto the floor of the hallway, as John desperately tried to get free from the rapidly enveloping tendrils around his leg. As their grip tightened, his service weapon, still in its holster, fell to the ground, out of reach from him. "What are you waiting for? Get the duck out here," he yelled. Refusing his orders, I dove to the floor and grabbed his gun. With the absolute minimal amount of firearms knowledge I possessed, I picked up the weapon and started firing at the center of the creature, frantically pulling the trigger. And I didn't stop until the excessively loud shots were replaced by silent clicks. Though the rounds barely fazed the creature, it loosened its grip on John just enough for him to crawl away from certain death. I helped him to his bleeding feet, and together we rushed through into the next train car, where we pulled loose some chairs and used them as a poorly constructed blockade to slow down the creature. We continued through the car, repeatedly tripping over the dozens of corpses littering the floor. I took a peek back at the barricade to see the creature slowly seeping through like a black fog, before reforming itself on the other side. "Hurry up," John yelled at me. The creature had almost fully formed by the time we got through the next car. Unable to grab us, it quickly realized we were out of reach. And in response, it split open its body down the middle, revealing rows of black teeth and multiple tendrils that resembled tongues. It let out a horrific, high-pitched shriek that shook the entire train, almost destroying my eardrums. The sound itself awakened the dead people strewn across the hallway. They lifted their heads and looked around until they fixated their eyes on us, which alerted the creature to our presence. It moved quickly, all the while its tendrils stretched impossibly far towards us in a hungry attempt at catching us. We were almost at the dining car when I fell back to the ground. A tendril had wrapped around my shoe, and John quickly grabbed my arms as I was pulled away. I screamed, and the door to the dining car shot open. Two men and a woman ran over and helped John pull me free from the tendril's grip. One of my shoes slid off in the process, allowing me to get away. We ran through the door and shut it behind us, while one of the men pulled a large metal rod through a makeshift lock. Both John and I lay wheezing on the floor from exhaustion as I tried to look around, observing my new surroundings. The car was full of booths with a small bar all the way up front, covered in canned foods and bottled water. In the corner I saw a few bags full of waste and empty food wrappings. The entire car was dimly lit up by a couple of rows of emergency lights on the ceiling, and it was clear they'd survived there for a couple of weeks already. Though if the four of them were all that remained, I didn't know. "What the hell happened to you, John?" a man in his 50s asked. They must have seen me coming. "I don't know how," John said, still out of breath. They kept looking at him in shock, not satisfied by his answer, so he continued. "I didn't even use the flashlight until I saw Thomas here, and by then they'd already awoken." "So you waited until they went back to sleep?" the woman asked. "No, they'd already seen us. We had to make a run for it. I came back as quickly as I could." His last sentences shut everyone up, and John started confused at them. "John, you were gone for 2 days," she finally said. "Don't be ridiculous." "I was gone for a couple of hours at the most." She pulled out a digital watch and showed John the time and date. "It's December 1st, she said quietly. "That's..." John trailed off, speechless by the realization. "How did they see you anyway?" "They're not exactly observant unless someone disturbs them," one of the men said in a condescending tone. "I don't know. Frank, do you think I did it on purpose?" I thought back to the old lady I'd seen in the first compartment, and realized John hadn't been discovered at all. I was the one that got caught. "Officer," I had tried to say before John interrupted me. "John," he corrected me, "we're in another ducking dimension or some shit. No need for ranks or titles." I tried to confess again, but the woman noticed John's bleeding leg and rushed over to him. "You're bleeding," she said. "It's nothing. The sentinel got a hold of my leg. Don't worry, I am fine. Just sit down. Let me have a look anyway." John sat down and the woman rolled up his trouser leg to reveal deep gashes in his calf. "You'll need stitches. Get me the med kit, will you?" she said as she pointed to Frank. While she did her best to fix up John's leg, I got a better look at the door. They'd reinforced it with pieces of metal around the edges, also covering the window, preventing the creature from seeping through the cracks, and its surveyors from seeing through it. On the wall beside the door, someone had etched lines, marking each past day. 19 lines for 19 days passed on a train that never stops. The oldest man, Frank, came over to me, looking as suspicious as ever. "Who are you?" he asked firmly. "Thomas," I responded. "You want to tell us how the hell you survived 19 days all on your own, without food or water?" I couldn't answer his question. To me, only a few hours had passed, and though I felt thirsty from fleeing, I wasn't even close to parched. "I don't know," I stuttered. "What do you mean, you don't know?" How can you not know? Frank said, getting agitated. Give him a break. Frank, if you hadn't left your bag behind, I wouldn't even have had to go out and risk my life, John interjected. It was enough to shut Frank up, though in a hole, he knew his place in the group. The other, younger guy came up to me and reached out his hand. I am Philip, and that's Mia, he said as he pointed to the woman fixing up John. And, lastly, that's Frank. Don't pay him any attention. He's a pain in the ass 90% of the time. Whatever, Frank interrupted. Did you get the batteries at least? Of course I did. You twat. They're in the bag, John said. I just stood there trying to get a grasp on the situation, barely responding to the other's questions. Don't worry about it, Thomas, Mia said as she noticed the absolutely baffled expression on my face. Huh, none of us remember what happened. We all just woke up at different times on the train, and had the idea to make our way here. It's safe, mostly, and the sentinels keep us from going out very often. You're lucky, John found you. Sentinels, the thing that chased us, John explained. A bright light penetrated the otherwise gloomy car, as Frank booted up his phone, using one of the battery packs. Without hesitation, he attempted to dial a number. Put it on speaker if you're trying to call someone, John said, still waiting for Mia to finish bandaging his leg. No one responded on the other end, but no sooner had Frank lowered the phone to input another number, before it started ringing blocked called ID. For a few moments, he just held the phone in shock, before he regained his senses and answered, hello. No response. Hello. Can anyone hear us? Frankie asked again. We listened intently to the emptiness on the other side of the line, and a minute passed without anyone speaking. There's no one there, Mia said. Before any of us could respond, the phone started emitting repetitive beeping sounds. They continued for almost a full minute, none of us daring to speak up while we listened. Once it was finished, the call ended on its own, and Frank looked around at us, wearing a confused expression. What the hell was that? John asked. No clue. It was just a bunch of beeps. Designation Gehenna. 108 hours. Do not get off the train, I said. What? It was Morse code. Learned it as a kid to secretly communicate in class. I know. It's dumb. I was a geek, but I am absolutely sure that's what the message said. They looked at each other for a moment, still visibly confused. Then back at me. Gehenna. What does it mean? Mia asked. Forget that, Frank interjected. Why are they telling us to stay on this ducking train? We fell silent again as Frank attempted to dial another number. To no avail. 108 hours. Just over 4 days before we reach our next station. We can do that. Just gotta stay here. We have enough provisions for at least 2 weeks, John said. So that's it. We just sit here in the dark for another 4 days, Frank asked. A small argument ensued, and while they discussed what we'd do at the train station, I took a moment to look out the window. The vast emptiness was horrifying on its own. I wondered how far the darkness reached, if it had an end, or if anything lived in the void. A part of me felt dead as I pondered these questions. I felt dead, as if the train was nothing more than a mere figment of my decaying mind. But the pain was ever too real. The tiredness felt too overwhelming for the world to be fake. I took my dead phone, grabbed one of the battery packs and plugged it in. The others were too busy discussing to notice me wasting power, but I just needed to write down some of my thoughts over text, ready to send if we happened to get a signal. I sent it to my dad, hoping he'd share the story should I not make it back. While I patiently waited for the text to go through, I kept staring into the dark. Some parts were blacker than their surroundings, and I then noticed they weren't just patches that contrasted with the rest of the environment, but moving things, almost vantablack, like a shadow moving through the night. It glided in the air alongside the train, quietly looming by with its eyeless body. It was a sentinel. Guys, I said quietly. They kept on arguing. Guys, there's a sentinel outside, I said much louder. John broke off from the argument and everyone fell silent as we watched the creature fly beside the train. Then we noticed another, and a third, and a fourth. And before long, we could make out hundreds, if not thousands of sentinels following the train. Don't worry, they shouldn't be able to see or hear us without their surveyors, Philip said. We all kept staring at the shadowy things in the void. And though Philip was right, they couldn't possibly see us without their aids. There was one undeniable fact about them that just didn't make sense. John grabbed and pulled me down to the floor, away from the window. Stay the duck down, he whispered. While we lay there, Frank and Philip rushed to cover up the windows with whatever debris and furniture they could get loose from the floor. Do they know we're here? Mia asked. Doesn't matter. We ain't taking any risks. We need to survive for 4 more days until we reach Gehenna, John responded. They were quick to block the windows, and within a minute we'd all settled down on the floor, where we tried to discuss our next more as quietly as possible. On the other side of the door, Leading to the next car, we could hear the shuffling of surveyors trying to get in. They knew we were here, which meant the sentinels would be alerted very soon. "They're behind the door," Frank said. "Can they hear us?" "Don't know, but stay quiet anyway. They might not know for sure that we're here," John said. "What about your gun? If we just kill the surveyors, they won't be able to alert the sentinels." "I don't have any ammo. Besides, that idea is ducking stupid." Even with the emergency lights dimly illuminating our car, it was hard to make out our surroundings. And with no idea how to turn them off, we could only pray that the surveyors didn't notice them either. A few hours passed with none of us daring to speak up, all fearing that the sentinels would come bursting in through the windows at any moment. The only one moving was Mia, and she only did so to check on John's leg. "Do we have any antibiotics in the bag?" she asked. Philip opened and rummaged through a large travel bag. In the dark he couldn't see much, and after a minute, he decided to just empty the bag of all the random items they'd gathered on the train, finally pulling out a box of pills. "Amoxicillin?" he half asked, half said. "That's all we have?" Mia asked. Philip nodded and tossed Mia the box. She handed them over to John, giving him instructions on when and how many to take. The first 24 hours, each marked by an innocuous beep from Mia's digital watch. I couldn't get my mind off the name Gehenna. It sounded familiar. It was definitely something I'd heard before, if only to be stuffed away in the back of my mind, polluted by pointless information I'd gathered throughout my life. 42 hours passed, as counted by the beeps. People were getting restless, unable to stand up or move around without alerting the surveyors. We still hadn't made a decision whether to stay on the train as we reached Gehenna, or to bail and try out our own luck elsewhere. "Are we really going to listen to some cryptic message?" Philip asked. "Like, I don't want to be all pessimistic, but why should we trust them? They're telling us to stay on the train. But do they mean as it stops, or now while it's heading there?" Mia asked. "Does it matter? Shouldn't we just do the exact opposite of what they tell us?" "No. Whatever happens, we're getting the duck off this train when it stops. As long as there's solid ground to walk on, we're not staying a minute longer than we have to," John interjected. 60 hours passed, and the void lingered outside our train, ever present and full of unseen horrors. Despite the stress, I'd somehow managed to drift off to sleep. Though restless, it was a deep sleep occupied by an incredibly vivid dream of Gehenna. I saw it as an empty ruin of a city, trapped in the center of a steep valley. Mia and Frank stood by my side with defeated expressions on their faces. As we observed our surroundings, a bright light lit up the gray sky, almost blinding us with its presence. I tried to lift my arms to block out at least some of the light, but I couldn't lift them. Something within the light had paralyzed me, surging through my body with intense pain. As I winced in agony, my mind suddenly felt clearer than it ever had. And then I remembered. It was just a piece of fragmented information long since forgotten, that I'd learned during my childhood during some religious class. Gehenna. It was hell, and we were heading straight for it. I awoke abruptly due to a high-pitched, glaring sound emitting from a speaker system, hidden in the ceiling. It jolted all of us to our feet in panic, as we tried to decipher what it meant. "What the hell is that sound?" John yelled as he clutched his ears. It was rhythmic. Morse code. Just like before, though, in the mess of static and distortions, I could barely make out the individual beeps. After a couple of minutes, despite the mess of sounds, it became apparent that the sound was just a loop of beeps with a simple message played on repeat. "Leaving vacuums, stand by. Leaving vacuums, stand by. Leaving vacuums, stand by. Leaving vacuums, stand by." It was incredibly loud, vibrating enough to loosen the already fragile barricade in front of the door and windows. On the other side, the surveyors were trying to break through, and with a final push, the door gave in. Dozens of them flooded in through the broken barricade, stumbling over each other in the process. All the while, they kept their eyes fixated on each of us, non-blinking, full of agony. "Push them out," John yelled, as he rushed at them with a stick, shoving the one furthest behind back through the door, then the next. But they kept getting back up. The rest of us rushed to aid John in his futile attempt, but before we could even reach him, every single window in the train shattered from the force of hundreds of sentinels throwing their mangled bodies at the car. Covered in shards of broken glass, I fell to the ground alongside Frank, who tried to use me for balance. A piece of glass cut my left eye, temporarily blinding me from pain. As I got the piece of glass out, I saw the sentinels digging their way through the broken windows, turning to a viscous fog and poured in through each crack in our barricade, reforming themselves on the other side. Just like before, it was hopeless. And all we could do was to stand there in frozen panic, unable to think of any plausible escape. Mia and Philip had sought cover in one of the corners, where they sat embracing each other, while John charged at the sentinels wielding nothing more than a kitchen knife. As the mix of sentinels and surveyors came at us, the alarm kept blaring, and I prepared for my quickly approaching demise, leaving vacuous, standby. Suddenly an impossibly bright light filled the entire void, instantly turning the sentinels to mere filaments of darkness lingering in the air. It persisted for minutes, completely blinding out any memory of the empty void we'd left behind. And then the speaker gave out a new message in the form of Morse code, designation Gehenna, 18 hours, do not get off the train, the code said. As quickly as it had come, the light faded. It took a while before our eyes adjusted, but once they did, we were greeted by a brand new world outside the windows. The once empty void had been replaced by endless fields of bright green grass, only contrasted by tall, blue mountains in the horizon. Miles and miles away, the sentinels themselves had all but vanished, while the surveyors had turned back into lifeless corpses, now doing nothing more than littering the hallways. Where are we? Mia asked. Gehenna, did we make it? Frank asked. No, we still have 18 hours left, I corrected him. I took a hopeful look out the window, and stared at the lush fields just out of reach. The ground looked so soft, and I contemplated for a moment whether it would be smarter to just jump off the train. That idea was quickly put to rest as I got a look around the train, now filled with blissful daylight that had immediately changed the mood. Alright, let's head for the locomotive and try to shut this train down, John said. We quickly made our way through the train, littered with the fresh corpses of people that died weeks ago. Their connections to the sentinels had been broken, leaving them limp on the ground with no direction. Once we reached the locomotive, we were faced with a heavy iron wall blocking our entrance, a door with no handle, nor a keyhole to open it. Great, what now? Frank asked. Maybe we can climb out one of the windows and get there from the outside, John suggested. Before we could even indulge the idea of climbing on the outside of a moving train, we were all shoved to the ground as the train rapidly lost speed. The track screeched as the wheels locked themselves in place, and we quickly came to a sudden stop. What the hell just happened? We've stopped, but there's no platform or anything outside, Mia said as she peeked outside the window. Doesn't matter. Get your stuff. We're getting off this nightmare. We returned to the dining car and picked up our bags, alongside any amount of food and supplies we could possibly carry. We hadn't yet reached Gehenna, but considering the implications that we were heading straight for hell, this would be a safer bet. For the first time in weeks, we stepped down on solid ground, with a brilliant green field only a few feet away from us. Philip took charge, carrying what little medical supplies we had left, while John followed. There was a decently brisk wind that felt great in otherwise hot climate, but the grass didn't seem to sway even the slightest. As minute a detail as it seemed, it warranted a closer look. They were crystals, green, razor-sharp crystals that from just a few feet away resembled blades of grass. Wait, don't I tried to yell, but it was too late, and Philip stepped down hard on the field. Ow. Duck, he yelled as the crystals cut through his shoes, into the sole of his foot. The rest of us froze in our step as we saw Philip pull back in agony, clutching his leg. It's not grass, I trailed off. Duck, it hurts, Philip groaned. Mia instinctively ran to his aid and pulled of his shoe. Let me have a look, she said. There were green crystals embedded deep in his sole, covered in jagged edges, making it almost impossible to pull out without causing more damage. We've got to get you back on the Mia froze mid-sentence. The crystal was spreading, with tiny shards breaking off, embedding themselves into Philip's skin, tearing through it as they grew. While what's happening? Philip stuttered. Though the growth was slow at first, it quickly sped up, covering his entire foot within a minute, before proceeding up his leg. Get them off me, he yelled in pain as Mia reached out to try to rip them off, but John stopped her before she could touch them. Wait, you'll get them on you too, John yelled. He pulled out his knife, and got ready to peel the shards off Philip, but the crystal simply cut through the knife like butter, spreading onto that as well. In shock, John stumbled back and dropped his knife. Mia once again tried to run over and help him, but we all held her back. All we could do was to stare at Philip as the crystals dug their way into his body, his bones audibly cracking and his skin rupturing as they continued spreading. He just lay there screaming in agony until the crystals got to his lungs. And before long, his entire body had been turned to rock. Before we could process, or mourn our loss, the crystals started spreading along the ground, slowly making their way towards us. Back on the train, John screamed. As we got back on board, we did our best to seal the doors and windows, but even then we had no proof it would stop the spread. The train had broken down, and with no way of getting it back up and running, all we could do was to wait as the green field of crystals spread onto the train. And to us, it's just a matter of time.